Welcome, Dr. Mike Hansen here. And in this video, I'm going to talk about some of the things that I've learned while working in the COVID ICU unit. So some intensive care units in various hospitals throughout this country have designated units for COVID-19 patients. And as an intensive care doctor myself, I've been seeing a lot of COVID patients in our designated COVID ICU. It's one thing to read about COVID in the medical literature, but to be actually seeing real patients with disease is a whole nother experience altogether. There are lots of things I've learned, but for this video, I'm going to focus on the top 10 that stand out to me. So starting at the bottom with number 10 is I'm going to talk about the signs and the symptoms. So the most common symptoms that I'm seeing are fever, cough, shortness of breath, and body and muscle aches. I haven't seen many patients with other symptoms we often hear about, such as loss of taste and smell or nausea and diarrhea. I have not seen any rashes related to COVID, probably because I only see adult patients. I will say that even though confusion and delirium is very common in the intensive care unit in general, there does seem to be more of that with COVID. So a lot of COVID-19 patients who require hospitalization do have low vitamin D levels. And this is consistent with what we're seeing in a lot of the recent studies that have been coming out. But of course, correlation doesn't necessarily mean causation. So does it just so happen that a lot of patients who have moderate or severe COVID happen to have low vitamin D levels? Maybe, maybe not. And does that mean that we should give every hospitalized patient with COVID big doses of vitamin D when they hit the door? Maybe. And does that mean people in general should supplement with vitamin D? And what is the ideal level of vitamin D for the population, especially when it comes to COVID? Should we be targeting the current general recommendation for everyone, irrespective of COVID, with a goal of 20 ng per ml? Or should we aim for higher, like 30 or perhaps 40? No one knows for sure the answers to these questions, but there are studies being done on this. And as we speak, there are 3 randomized controlled trials for vitamin D and COVID. I take a further deep dive into vitamin D in some of my other videos on this channel, so if you want, you can check those out. So number 8, this virus is very contagious. One of my patients was in the hospital for unrelated reasons. She actually had sepsis due to infarcted gut, meaning part of her intestine was not getting enough blood flow. It was so severe to the point that some of the tissue in her intestine had died off. When this happens, the bacteria that live in the intestine can then invade the walls of the intestine and get into the bloodstream. This is bad news because these bacteria can then spread throughout the body, and this is known as sepsis. So besides antibiotics, this is treated with surgery where the dead gut tissue is removed, meaning part of the intestine is taken out. And this is what happened with her, and she got better. But after she initially got better, she started having more difficulty with her breathing. Her oxygen levels were dropping, despite us giving her more and more oxygen. So we got a chest x-ray and later a CAT scan of the chest, which showed bilateral infiltrates, meaning areas of inflammation in both lungs. And this is the pattern we typically see with COVID pneumonia, where it tends to go to the periphery of the lungs and also more so at the bottom of the lungs. So we tested her for COVID, and sure enough, the PCR test came back positive. Unfortunately, she did not survive. So how did she get COVID? No one really knows. Of course, she got it in the hospital, but there weren't any known healthcare workers who had COVID, and she did not have any visitors because of the visitor policy. So it's a mystery as to how this stealthy virus was transmitted to her, which speaks to just how contagious the virus really is. I've also seen entire families who live under one roof all hospitalized. So yeah, pretty contagious. And that leads me to number 7, which is because of the no visitor policy, it sure is lonely for patients in the hospital, and it's incredibly hard for family members to not be with their loved ones, especially when they may not survive. So as if dying is not bad enough, some of them die alone, which is obviously horrible. Based on my experience, it's hard to really get a gauge on the treatments that we give. So for most patients, depending on individual circumstances, we're giving remdesivir, convalescent plasma, dexamethasone, and even therapeutic doses of blood thinners. So for the blood thinners, meaning anticoagulation, I've been giving Lovenox, aka enoxaparin, if their kidney function is okay. Or alternatively, if their kidney function is not okay, we give another blood thinner like heparin. We still don't know for sure who we should be treating with full doses of blood thinners because it's usually not practical to try and diagnose blood clots in someone who's sick with COVID in the hospital. There are various reasons for this. One, there's no single test that can definitively diagnose clots in the body. Every test that looks for clots, either with an ultrasound of the leg or a CT angiogram of the chest or a VQ scan of the lungs, or a CT scan of the brain looking for a stroke, or a blood test checking the D-dimer, all of these things can have false negatives. Not only that, but for each of these tests, they all have their own risks. For example, with a CT angiogram, not only are you giving them the radiation from the CAT scan, but you're also giving them contrast, which means they could potentially have an allergic reaction, or they can also get some kidney damage from that contrast. Never mind the potential spread of the virus when you move the patient to the CT scanner. So because the incidence of blood clots in COVID patients who have severe disease is thought to be around 30 to 40% or so, most ICU doctors, including myself, are opting to just empirically treat all COVID patients in the ICU with therapeutic doses of blood thinners. Now, the downside, of course, is the risk of bleeding. So it's a judgment call at this point. Some doctors also base their decision on how high the D-dimer level is. But again, we simply don't know at this point if we should do that or not. But we do see a lot of clots in patients. I had one patient who had severe COVID to the point of requiring a ventilator. It was also severe enough to the point of causing her kidneys to shut down. When we were doing dialysis on her, the machine kept clogging up with blood clots. And later on, we were able to take out the breathing tube once her breathing finally got better. But something was off with her from a neurologic standpoint. Now, I really don't like sending COVID patients to the CAT scan because then you risk spreading the virus throughout the hospital. But sometimes you have to do it. And in this case, I did. I ended up biting the bullet. And sure enough, she unfortunately had a stroke. And as far as all the other treatments I mentioned, including convalescent plasma, I can't really say one way or another if they're making a difference. If they are making a difference, it's not obvious. It's not like you give any of these treatments and patients are all of a sudden magically better. So that's why we always need scientific studies in the form of randomized controlled trials to really know if a treatment is working or not. So for number five, I'm gonna go with testing. I think testing is still a guessing game at this point. One of my patients who was in the ICU for more than 20 days, so he initially tested positive with the PCR test, and then we ended up retesting him about 3 weeks after that, and he again tested positive. So does that mean he can still spread the virus to other people? Maybe. Or it just might be that the PCR test is picking up the inactivated viral RNA, and these viral remnants are causing the test to be positive, even though it's possible he's no longer shedding the virus. All right, number four, a lot of my COVID patients are obese or morbidly obese. And here's the thing, a lot of people who are obese have obstructive sleep apnea. And a lot of people who are obese, especially if they're morbidly obese, have something called obesity hypoventilation syndrome, which is a fancy way of saying that they're not able to breathe off as much carbon dioxide as they should because of their body habitus. Sometimes when an obese patient is in the hospital and we suspect they have obstructive sleep apnea, we give them a CPAP machine to use at night. Or if they have obesity hypoventilation syndrome, we give them a BiPAP machine, which is essentially the same thing as CPAP, except instead of blowing air into the mouth and nose using one constant pressure, the BiPAP does two different pressures, one at a higher pressure and then one at a lower pressure. So the higher one is for inhalation, while the lower pressure is for exhalation. In fact, that's what BiPAP means, bi-level positive airway pressure. Well, when someone is COVID positive, that kind of throws a wrench into our plans because CPAP and BiPAP generate aerosols in the room, which means you can potentially have that virus being thrown around the room from the CPAP or the BiPAP. So that means the patient would have to be transferred to a negative airflow room. And negative airflow rooms are limited, so they might not be available, especially in times of a pandemic. That's what makes the surge in cases recently all the more concerning because more cases means more hospitalizations, which of course means less negative airflow rooms, less ICU rooms available. Okay, number three on the list is mechanical ventilation. So a couple things with this. One, it's still really hard to know when or if we should intubate someone, meaning put a breathing tube down someone's throat. Some patients have very low oxygen levels while not necessarily being in respiratory distress, meaning they may not feel short of breath or have air hunger, or they're not necessarily breathing that fast and deep. So the question becomes, how low are we willing to let their oxygen levels go before we decide on putting the breathing tube in? So the decision to intubate is much easier when someone is in respiratory distress. Once the patient is intubated, the settings that we dial in on the ventilator really have to be catered towards that patient. And while this is true of intubated patients in general, this is even more so with COVID because of the variability of their lung disease. Meaning some patients might have more inflammation and ARDS compared to others, while other patients might have more blood clots and less inflammation. So some patients might be obese, while others might not be obese. There are really so many factors that go into how we manage patients on the ventilator. So it's pretty common where we're really tinkering around with those vent settings, trying out different modes on there, different settings. So some patients do better when they're prone and others not so much. Some patients need to be given a paralytic medication in order to be synchronous with the ventilator, while others don't need paralytics. So it's not one size fits all with all these patients. And some patients don't need the ventilator, while others might only need it for a couple days, while others need it for weeks. And when someone needs a ventilator for a few weeks or longer, that's when we need to do a tracheostomy, meaning make a small hole in the neck to fit a smaller size breathing tube. We do this because the original breathing tube, meaning the endotracheal tube, can only be left in for so long before the risk of complications from that really start to climb. Typically, the arbitrary cutoff is 2 weeks, but with COVID, we're generally waiting for 3 weeks. All right, number two, recovery. So as an intensive care doctor, I see patients in the intensive care unit, but as a pulmonologist, meaning a lung doctor, I also see patients in the pulmonary clinic. So I'm able to follow patients who have not only had COVID in the ICU, but then see how they do in their recovery in the pulmonary clinic afterwards. I had a young patient in his 40s who was not obese and who was otherwise healthy, who was on the cusp of requiring a breathing tube when he was in the hospital. His CAT scan showed the pneumonia in both lungs. Ultimately, he didn't require the breathing tube and he slowly got better, but he needed to be discharged home with supplemental oxygen. And he's still not 100% back to normal, and this is now 3 months after he first got the virus. Thankfully, he's alive, but his lungs suffered a lot of damage. Will his lung function fully recover? I don't know, only time will tell. Sometimes with ARDS, due to viral pneumonias, there can be permanent damage, but lots of times the damage from all the inflammation there slowly gets better with time. And something I forgot to mention is he actually had something pretty unusual happen to him. Not that it's unheard of, but it's pretty uncommon for it to happen, and that is, he developed something called a pneumatocele as a result of having pneumonia. So what is a pneumatocele? It's a cyst in the lungs that develops after an infection and or ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome. A cyst is a thin-walled bubble, if you will. Now, in his case, it really formed between the upper and middle lobe of his right lung. But because of the fluid that we can see inside, there was the possibility that this was an abscess, and that's why we treated him with an antibiotic, especially because he was having pain in the right side of his chest. Especially when he would take a deep breath, the pain would actually become worse. So this is known as pleuritic chest pain. Oh, and here's a fun fact for you. Did you know that the lungs themselves don't have pain receptors? However, the lining of the lungs, called the pleura, do have pain receptors. So anything that disrupts the pleura can cause pain. So this can include adjacent pneumonia in the lungs. And in this patient's case, it was the cyst and possibly abscess that was irritating the pleura, the lining of the lung, and this was causing his chest pain. But getting back to some of my other patients who had severe COVID, some of them required intubation for a few weeks and survived, and some of them required a tracheostomy, while others did not. So why some people have worse disease than others still hasn't been sorted out. Yes, we know that severe disease is more likely with older age. Other medical problems like diabetes, high blood pressure, obesity, type A blood, but we don't know why. Is viral load part of the reason? Maybe. I'm sure genetics are a big part of it as well, but we don't know what specific genes or genetic variations. Okay, number one on this list is unpredictability and variability of this virus and this disease. So this virus and this disease is just so unpredictable in so many ways. Who gets sick? The variation of the symptoms, the variation in severity of disease, the variability of timing where someone can be relatively fine all of a sudden, and then boom, within hours, they require a breathing tube. How some people get more inflammation while others get more clots. How some people recover quicker than others. How some people have the disease, but their test is negative, meaning they have false negative. So we're all still learning about this virus and this disease in real time, and there's a lot to learn. And hopefully we can get a vaccine for this that is both safe and effective, and hopefully enough people get the vaccine for herd immunity to take place. But a vaccine itself is not a guarantee, especially because we don't know how long these coronavirus antibodies are protective. And there are more and more drugs being studied, and some look more promising than others, but only time will tell with more randomized controlled trials. But for now, we have to social distance and use masks because That's the only thing we have at this point, and this virus isn't going away anytime soon. But anyway, thanks for watching this video. I have more videos on the way, of course. I think the next one's gonna be on convalescent plasma. So check that out, and I will see you in the next one.